Bottomland hardwood forests are forested wetlands found along rivers, streams, and drainage areas. The trees growing in these forests have the ability to survive in areas that are either seasonally flooded or covered with water much of the year.
Bottomland hardwoods are extremely important as wildlife habitat. We've got high degree of diversity in bottomland hardwoods. There's a lot of structural diversity in terms of the different sizes of the trees, the different species of trees that are in bottomland hardwood forest ecosystems.
In addition to hunting, these bottomland hardwoods and green tree reservoirs provide economic benefits such as carbon sequestration, biological diversity, and non-hunting related wildlife viewing. Timber harvests from these forests represent close to $50 million, and carbon sequestration opportunities could add another $25 to $30 million to this total.
Bottomland hardwoods acreage along the Mississippi alluvial zone drastically declined at the turn of the century.
Tens of thousands of acres of these forested wetland systems were converted to cropland. But even with the massive earth-moving efforts, many of these converted areas still were not viable lands for most crops.
Unfortunately, much of the remaining bottomland hardwoods and levee-impounded green tree reservoirs in the region are compromised from years of altered hydrology and extended flood durations.
Simply put, these areas were better suited to the types of vegetation that were there previously, bottomland hardwood systems.
Starting back in the 1980s, there's been a very aggressive push to restore a lot of those lost forest ecosystems.
Many of these areas have begun wetland restoration efforts with the goal of reestablishing the hydrology and vegetation historically characteristic of bottomland hardwood systems.
Because of the recognition of their importance ecologically, there's been a lot of new acreage established and continues to be established all along the Mississippi alluvial zone. So we're getting a big restoration of acreage of those lost ecosystems.
Most of that effort is focused on restoring hydrology and planting trees like red oaks that don't easily seed in.
Restoring wetland functions isn't something that can be done by simply moving earth. So during restorations, it is first important to try to recreate variability in the landscape. To get the range of wetland functions and the diversity of plant communities that we expect in bottomland hardwoods, variability of hydrology is essential. Two restoration projects that I've worked on in Drew and Chicot counties looked at changes in soil, physical, and chemical properties, as well as changes in vegetation communities in an area undergoing restoration of wetland hydrology. A couple of the specific things I compared in my studies was how well an area that was 10 years into a restoration mimicked the soil and plant characteristics in a similar area that had never been converted from a bottomland hardwood system. While having a variety of landforms across the landscape in the natural system is critical for its nature and function, that variability creates challenges for collecting data, enough data, to allow us to tease out significant differences in any treatments applied or measurements taken. My graduate students and I did note some significant changes in vegetation in the restoration area, changes suggestive of a beginning to the return of more natural communities. The changes in key soil properties, bulk density, soil organic carbon, and others still had not made recoveries to levels similar to the natural system. Other studies in different areas of the country have seen relatively quick recoveries, which just illustrates that there is no single recipe or time frame for these systems to be restored. There's a lot of work that still remains to be done to identify the best restoration approaches for a range of bottomland hardwood forest systems. We can reestablish the large vegetation, the trees, relatively easily with planting efforts and management of the water. Are there certain amendments that can be added to the soil during restorations to expedite the restoration of a forested wetland system? I think the key is the reestablishment of appropriate microbial communities that regulate nutrient and carbon cycling, perhaps amendments with specific fertilizers, or additions of carbon-rich materials, perhaps biochar, could be beneficial. The nuanced functions that these bottomland forested wetland systems provide, nutrient cycling, water and waste purification, and so on, often are challenging to restore, and there is no simple standard recipe for restoring these essential functions.
It's exciting to see that conservation and restoration efforts have increased the acreage of bottomland hardwood forest by about 1 million acres in the Mississippi Valley. But assessment of long-term success was never built into those bottomland forest restoration efforts. So we're working now to see if these restoration projects are achieving their goals, like mature trees and forests that provide ecosystem services like habitat for wildlife, clean water, and removal of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. And with the information we're gathering, we'll be able to recommend better management practices to optimize those benefits and maintain the healthy development of those forests. Red oaks are so important in bottomland forests, but they can be severely stressed by flooding during spring, summer, and fall. They're much more tolerant of flooding, though, when they're dormant in the winter. One of the biggest stresses from flooding is low oxygen availability to roots in the soil. Roots need oxygen just like we do. When there's not enough oxygen, the roots will die. We think that decreased growth, metabolism, and decreased oxygen demand of roots during the dormant season may be one of the ways they become more tolerant to flooding. We can take an overarching measurement of metabolism by measuring respiration, and that's the amount of CO2 given off by roots. There's almost no data like this on roots of southern tree species, especially during the winter. If we can figure out when root activity declines during winter, and more important, what causes root activity to decline, we can use those cues to decide when it's safe to flood without harming the red oaks.
In addition to helping to improve water quality and mitigate flood severity, bottomland hardwood forests provide habitats that support a very rich diversity of plants and animals, including migratory songbirds, many species of waterfowl, and of course white-tailed deer and black bears.
Arkansas historically winters the largest concentration of mallards in North America. These birds are coming here for the resources that become available in the bottomland hardwoods during winter. Bottomland hardwoods are also provide protective cover from the elements during the winter and are essentially important for pair bonding, pre-breeding activities, and maintenance of body condition during winter.
We know that hunters spend more than $400 million a year annually in the state of Arkansas on waterfowl hunting. That represents more than 10% of our national total, and more than $1,500 a year are spent per hunter in the state of Arkansas. These numbers have been growing rapidly at a rate of more than 15% per year.
Changes in hydrologies have resulted in a decline of individual tree health, stand structure, and shifts in species composition to more water-tolerant species. The decline in forest health is impacting two very important social economic drivers in the state of Arkansas, timber production and waterfowl hunting. It is no secret, and many of the duck hunters can attest, that migration patterns and local movements of wintering waterfowl are changing, consequently impacting their hunting opportunities and harvest success in the state. To learn more about these changes in waterfowl populations, we are using data from our ongoing 7-year banding program to assess timing of migration and distribution of wintering waterfowl. We have banded nearly 17,000 mallards in the past 7 years in the Grand Prairie and the Delta regions of Arkansas and into Mississippi. We are now using satellite transmitters to learn about changes in migration patterns and determine the impacts of declining forest health on the fine scale movements of mallards in Arkansas. Specifically, moving forward, the students with the Five Oaks Agriculture and Research and Education Center will be filling data gaps in our knowledge of how the loss of red oaks and changes to stand structure and species composition in these flooded timbers are impacting waterfowl populations.
I am currently conducting 2 black bear research projects in the bottomland hardwood forests of southern and eastern Arkansas. Interestingly, black bear populations in these regions of the state are increasing. To manage these populations according to science-based principles and to determine if the bear populations have reached a size where they can sustain a regulated hunting season, the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission needs to know how many bears occur in these regions and where the high and low bear densities are located on the landscape. Therefore, I am estimating population abundance and density of black bears in southern and eastern Arkansas. This research involves using barbed wire to snag bear hair, extracting the DNA from the hair samples, and using the DNA to individually identify each bear. I will then use what is called a capture mark recapture model to estimate population abundance. DNA-based population estimation techniques, such as the one that I am using, are fairly commonly used today in wildlife science, especially in large mammal research. This project is unique in that it is one of the largest of its kind ever conducted. In addition to estimating population abundance, I'm also using my bear DNA to better understand bear movements over large landscapes, including the potential movement of bears between the Ouachitas in western Arkansas and southern Arkansas, and the movement of Louisiana black bears north into the Delta region of southern Arkansas. This research, funded by the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation, the Arkansas Agricultural Experiment Station, which is the research arm of the University of Arkansas System Division of Agriculture, and the McIntyre Stennis Program of the U.S. Department of Agriculture, will provide the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission with the bear population data they need to establish black bear hunting regulations in southern and eastern Arkansas. In another research project, one of my graduate students, Katie Hickel, and I are constructing a habitat suitability index model for black bears on the Cache River National Wildlife Refuge and the north unit of the Dale Bumpers White River National Wildlife Refuge, both located in eastern Arkansas. Habitat suitability index models provide location-specific information on the capacity of a given habitat to support a species of interest. For reasons currently unknown, black bears do not occur or are very rare on both Cache River and the north unit of White River. The U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service wants to know why. This research, funded by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, the Division of Agriculture's Arkansas Agricultural Experiment Station, and the McIntyre Stennis Program of the U.S. Department of Agriculture, will provide the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service with the black bear habitat data they need to apply location-specific habitat management on both refuges to improve habitat conditions for black bears. It is exciting to have the opportunity to play a role in recovering black bears to the Cache and White River region in eastern Arkansas. This is the kind of stuff large mammal ecologists like me dream about.
The reason that eastern Arkansas is so renowned for its duck hunting is it's got a landscape covered in rice fields and flooded timber. And our faculty have been doing work in those areas for quite a long time. The College of Forestry, Agriculture, and Natural Resources at the University of Arkansas at Monticello has a lot of unique strengths that help build a partnership like we have at Five Oaks.
The Bottomland Hardwoods and Green Tree Reservoirs of Arkansas offer some tremendous economic benefits for the state. However, landowners aren't capturing all of the opportunities that are possible to them, and the Five Oaks Initiative will provide us with better management information, and using that information, the Arkansas Forest Business Center will be providing better economic information to support better policy decisions and better land management.
The partnership with the University of Arkansas System and Five Oaks is an exciting opportunity for our students and for research, for our bottomland hardwood resource, and for waterfowl populations.
With these students coming in to better understand habitat management, our biggest goal is to perpetuate the next group of managers. The next generation is the only way we save the resource.
It's a very unique partnership in that, working with the University of Arkansas at Monticello, which has a wonderful forestry school. It just seems like a natural partnership between the outdoors, the natural resources, and the science of it. I'm really excited about this and the possibilities that this is going to bring in the future.
I think the future of the Bottomland Hardwood ecosystem is looking upward. I think bringing together this group of experts with the elite expertise of Five Oaks and their elite resources is generating a partnership that is going to cultivate a next generation of wildlife habitat managers and a body of knowledge on improving waterfowl habitat management that will enhance and sustain the waterfowl lands of Arkansas for generations to come.